What's going on, guys? It is Bernardo, and today is all about how to install Zabbix 6.0 with Debian version 11. So let's get right into that. All right, so the first thing that we're going to do is head to zabbix.com, and we are going to locate the download section, and you're going to pick your flavor. For me, for this video, we are going to download Zabbix 6.0 LTS within a Debian OS. Version 11, we're going to use MySQL as the database, and the web server is going to be Apache. Now, within this section right here, it actually gives you the step-by-steps on how to install it. I took a different route with my installation, and I still got it to work. I think when I followed the instructions on their webpage, I had issues, but this is how I did it. So I clicked on the Debian 11.3.0 AMD64 and it started downloading. The file is about 400 megabytes. So once it's done, you are good to go. Now I am installing my Zabbix server into VMware EXXI. So I'm going to click on create / register a VM. You're going to get the new virtual machine wizard. I'm going to create a new virtual machine. Click next here. You're going to provide a name. The guest OS family is going to be Linux. And for the OS version, it's going to be a Debian GNU Linux version 11, 64-bit. From here, click next. And you're going to select your storage. Once you pick your storage, click next here, and you're going to customize your settings. Now, this is really up to you. For me, I gave it the following. I gave it 2 CPUs, 4 gigs of memory, 100 gigs of hard drive space, and at the very bottom, just make sure you mount that ISO, and you click on connect at power on, right? And then click next. A nice little summary. Click finish, locate your new virtual machine, click on it, and you're going to click on the power button and it's going to launch up. The first thing that's going to happen is it's going to want you to pick how you want the installation to happen. So by default, it is going to do graphical install. So I just hit enter here. You're going to pick your language and just click continue. What location you're in, once you pick that, continue. Your keyboard type, pick that. All right, so it's gonna start loading the additional components. You need to provide a host name. Once you do that, hit continue. Provide a domain name. Once you do that, continue. You need to provide a root password. And once you confirm your root password, just hit continue on that. Now you need to create a new username or a new user account within your Debian OS. So give it a name and hit continue. Confirm the new name, and then you need to give it a password, and then confirm the password. And then once you confirm the password, just hit continue. You need to configure your clock. So once you configure your time zone, just click next here. And for the partition disk, I basically just went with the route of guided use entire disk and just hit continue. I picked my partition disk, which I only have one, and hit continue. For partitioning your disk, I left it as the default as all files in one partition. So click continue and make sure that you highlight finish partitioning and write changes to disk and then click on continue. From this option here, you definitely want to do yes because you do want to write the changes on the disk and hit continue. It's going to start partitioning, formatting the disk, installing the base system, and then it's going to want you to install extra stuff. This is really up to you. I think I picked no from here and I just hit continue. It's going to want you to configure your package manager. I picked United States and I hit continue here. It is then going to want you to pick the location, archive mirror. So by default, it is going to pick something for you. So I left it as whatever it picked for me. So I hit continue. If you have a proxy, enter your proxy. If not, just leave it blank and hit continue here. For configuring any popular contests, this is up to you. I hit no and I hit continue. Now for my installation, I pick XFCE. I like that desktop environment, but it's really up to you what you're comfortable with. And hit continue. It's going to start installing the software. And the next thing is installing the Grub bootloader. So hit yes on that, hit continue. And then you are going to select your device. Hit continue here. It's going to start installing the bootloader. Once it's done, you're going to get installations completed. Awesome. So we got the operating system completed and it's done. Hit continue. It's going to reboot, and it is time for us to log in. So log into the machine. First thing that we need to do within the machine is open up terminal. First command is we need to push out any updates. And the next command is do an app upgrade. So app update, app upgrade are the first two commands that we need to do on this machine. Once you push out all the updates and the upgrade, you're able to continue. So because I'm doing everything within a virtual environment, I did an app install OpenVMTools desktop with a parameter of -y to confirm the installation. And this is going to install the VMware tools on this box. So once that's done, I did a command of reboot. And the reboot is basically just going to restart the machine, log back in, and open up terminal. The next command that we are going to do is we are going to configure our IP address. I don't want to use a DHCP. I want to do a static IP. So we need to go into this particular file, which is located inside the ETC network interfaces. And we're going to use Nano as our text editor. And the first thing that we need to do is auto, but we need to know the name of our network interface. Now to do that, open up another terminal tab or another terminal command, and we need to do the following command, IP-C address show. And what we're looking for is for number two. The network card is actually named ENS192. That's what we need. And the IP address is 119, which is what I'm going to use. Again, it is set up as DHCP, but I want to use static. So we're going to go back inside our text editor, and we're going to enter the following. So it's going to be auto ENS192, which is the name of the card. Interface ENS192, and we're doing a static. We're going to do address, give it the address, the network mask, the gateway, the DNS domain, and as well as your DNS name servers. Once you do that, you're going to basically save it, exit out of it, and I like to do a reboot command. And once it reboots, you're good to go. Now, I went inside my DNS server, and within my DNS server, I wanted to create a record. So within my DNS, I just basically right-clicked, picked on new host. And for the name, I provided the name, which would be vzabbix, and I gave it the IP address. Once you give the IP address, just click on add host. Successful, awesome, click OK, and there is our A record within our DNS server. Now, the next thing that I did within my environment before I did the installation was create a GPO. Now, the group policy is basically opening up a firewall port on my servers for zabbix to retrieve information and get those matrix like, you know, the C drive and the memory and all that stuff. So open up your group policy manager. And within here, you're going to open up group policy objects. And we're going to right click on that node and click on new. We're going to provide the following name. I'm going to call it server allowed zabbix. And we're going to click OK. We're going to locate our new GPO, highlight it, right click on it, and then pick on edit. And within here, we're going to go inside computer configuration, policies, Windows settings, security settings, Windows firewall with advanced security. We're going to pick Windows firewall with advanced security, which is weird. I don't know why Microsoft did that. And then within here, we're going to pick inbound rules. Now, within inbound rules, we're going to right click on that node and then pick on new rule. Now, we're going to select port and click on next. Now the port is going to be a TCP and the port number is going to be 10050. So it's 10050, okay? 10,050. And then click next here. We're going to allow the connection, click next. And this is really up to you. Where do you want to apply it? I think for me, I did domain. I didn't do private or public, but it's really up to you. And then once you do that, click next. And then you're going to provide a name. I provided the following name. You can give it whatever you want. It's up to you. And then click finish. Now, once you're done, you're going to take that GPO and you're going to link it to a particular OU. For me, I did the servers. And because I want all my servers to have that port open and I want zabbix to start grabbing information on those servers. All right, so let's head back to Debian and open up your terminal. And the first command that we're going to do is app install wget. This should be automatically installed into your machine. If not, make sure it is. Right here, it basically says already done. The next command that we need to do is grab MySQL package because we need to install our database for Zabbix. So this is a command that we need to write and hit enter. Once it's downloaded into your machine, and the next command that we need to do is app install, and we're calling out that DEB file. Okay, we need to, you know, install that MySQL installation package. So hit enter here. You're going to get this. Once you get this, you're going to hit tab and hit OK. You're going to get this. You're going to basically select what you want. You're going to hit tab again and OK. For me, it kept on looping, but eventually you want to just go down to OK, then hit enter, and then go down again and then select OK. Again, it's weird. And then just hit enter, and then it disappears, and then you're back here. Once you do the installation with MySQL, you need to do an app update. And once you do the app update, the next command is do an app install MySQL-server, hit enter there. You want to do a Y to confirm it. So now it's time for us to enter a root password for our database. So enter a password, hit enter, re-enter your root password again, hit enter again. And for the default authentication plugin, it's recommended to use a strong password encryption. I think for my environment, I'd use a legacy method. So it's really up to you how you want to do it within your environment. But for me, I picked legacy method and it worked out with no problem. Once you pick your option, it's going to take you back to the terminal and it's going to give you a progress bar. Once everything is completed, you're good to go. If you want to check your MySQL status, you're going to run the following command, hit enter, and it should say active and running, which is a good thing. We need to log into MySQL and start creating our database. So we're going to run the following command and we're going to hit enter, enter your root password, and it's going to get you this. It should take you this, right? If you enter the correct password. So the first command that we need to do is we're going to create our Zabbix database with the following character set. Make sure you have these character sets on this particular database. Now, this information, you can actually get it within the Zabbix, you know, website. Hit enter, complete it. The next command is we are going to create a user and we're going to identify the password for that user. So this is a user, and this is basically what Zabbix recommended on their site, but you're able to change it for your environment. Hit enter here. And the next command is we need to grant access to that database, to that new user that we created. So this is the command that we're going to run and just hit enter. And then we're going to do another command of quit to get out of it. Now we need to pull the Zabbix installation package. So this is the URL that we need to use using the wget command. Now again, this information, you can actually get it from the Zabbix website. Okay, so I just did a copy and paste the URL that they provided. I hit enter, it started downloading the installation package, and once it was done, I did the following command of dpkg with a parameter of dash I, and I called out that package. Once you do that, hit enter, and the next command that we need to do is app update. Once you do the app update, now you're able to install Zabbix within your machine using the particular parameters. All right, so you're going to do app install Zabbix server MySQL. You're going to install the front end with PHP. You're going to do the Apache. You're also going to download a couple of scripts for the database for Zabbix. And you're also going to download the Zabbix agent. So once you enter all this information, just hit enter. You're going to enter Y for yes and just hit enter. And once that's done, the next command that we need to do is the following. Again, you're going to be calling out a SQL script to make some modifications within your Zabbix database. So you're gonna pipe it to your Zabbix database. So you're going to do a parameter of dash u. U is basically the username, which is Zabbix. The parameter dash p is not the password, which was weird. Parameter p is the database. So you're calling the database. When you hit enter, then you're going to enter the password for the user. Okay, now this password is the one that you identified within your MySQL. So whatever you gave the Zabbix user account, that password for that account is what you're entering here. Okay. Once you hit enter, you won't get a progress bar, so don't freak out. Eventually, you're going to get a command prompt. Once you get the command prompt, that means it's done and we are able to continue. So the next command is we need to actually get inside the Zabbix underscore server config file. And within here, you need to basically make sure a couple of things are right. And the first thing is make sure that the DB name is correct. Make sure that the DB user is correct. And also make sure that the DB password is set correctly. If not, the next steps won't work at all. Now, we need to restart the Zabbix server as well as the agent. And we're going to run the following command. And we're going to hit enter. And then we're going to run the next command, which will allow us to enable Zabbix server and the agent to automatically restart if the server restarts because of updates or you restart it. Okay, so that's the next command that we're going to run, and we're going to hit enter from there. Now, once you hit enter, you restart your machine, make sure everything is up and running. You're going to open up your favorite browser. Within Debian, there's only Firefox, so we'll open up Firefox, and we're going to type in localhost with a forward slash of Zabbix and hit enter. You're going to get this, a nice welcome to Zabbix 6.0. We're going to click on next step. And from here, make sure everything is stated okay. If you have any issues, fix it. If not, if you got all okay and everything is green, click on next step. And it is time for us to configure a DB connection. The only thing that you need to provide is the password. So just enter the password and just click on next and everything should work. If you have a successful connection, it should take you to this right here to settings. Within settings, provide a server name and your time zone and your theme. I like the dark theme, which looks pretty cool and creepy. So click on next here. A nice pre-installation summary. And just click next here, and congratulations, you have successfully installed Zabbix front end. And so just click finish. Once you click finish, it's gonna take you to the portal. The username and password is admin. Make sure it's a capital A, it's case sensitive, crazy. And the password is Zabbix, and just click on sign in, and it should take you here. You should have one host, which is your Zabbix, because automatically your Zabbix server is being monitored within Zabbix. And finally, I went to another machine and I wanted to test out the full qualified domain. So I basically type in vzabbix.btnhd.edu/zabbix/index.php, hit enter, it takes you here. And you're good to go. Basically, that tells me my DNS is working with no problem. And rather than typing the IP address of the server, I'm able to type in the name of the server, which is awesome. And that's it. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this video, and I catch you guys on the next one. Peace out.